Majors, what are you doing?
Oh, hey, Nathan. I'm cleaning up around here. I invited the neighbors over to see the Bible then.
Neighbors? You invited the neighbors?
Yeah.
Well, haven't you noticed? I like to keep the Bible den a secret place. That's why the door is hidden in a bookshelf. And also, I don't really like the neighbors. The last time I saw them, they were kind of rude.
You know, Jesus says something about how we should treat our neighbors. We should tell that story.
Well, we better tell it quick before the neighbors get here and ruin it.
Nathan, they couldn't ruin a Bible story. They'd only make it better. Let's get into the Bible. Whoa. Travel with me back to the times of Bible times, where I want to continue telling stories about Jesus. One day, Jesus and his disciples were traveling to Jerusalem.
It was a long journey, but Jesus had an idea to make it shorter. They could take a shortcut through Samaria.
But if they were going to make this journey, they were going to need a place to stay in Samaria. So Jesus sent some disciples ahead to prepare for his arrival.
Wait, Jesus wanted to stay in Samaria? The land of the Samaritans?
That's right.
Well, Jesus was a Jew, and Samaritans hate Jews.
Really? Why did the Samaritans hate the Jews?
Hey, Dad, why did the Samaritans hate the Jews?
Well, the Jews and the Samaritans hated each other. The Samaritans claimed that they, not the Jews, were the true chosen people of God. They claimed their mountain, Mount Gerizim, was the true holy mountain and the true place God's temple belonged.
But the Bible says the Jewish people are God's chosen people, not the Samaritans.
Yep, and that's why the Samaritans took the Hebrew Bible and changed it to make themselves look like the true Israel. In reality, the Samaritans were the descendants of ancient Assyrians.
What? That's crazy.
But the Samaritans didn't stop there. They would often do everything they could to cause trouble.
Like what?
Once, during the Feast of Passover, the Samaritans defiled the Holy Temple. They snuck into the courts and tossed the bones of dead bodies all around.
Yuck!
Another time, they lit signal fires on hilltops to confuse the Jews, causing many of them to celebrate a feast on the wrong day of the month.
These Samaritans sound like real jerks.
The Samaritans would often lie about the Jews to try and get them in trouble. They created confusion and twisted the truth of the Bible. And at one point, the Samaritans began actively attacking any Jewish travelers that passed through Samaria. That's why the Jews and the Samaritans didn't get along so well.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Right. You see, the Samaritans believed that their mountain was the true place for the temple, and they hated the Jews for worshiping in Jerusalem. So when they found out that Jesus was going to Jerusalem, they refused to let him stay in their little village.
Wow. They turned away the Messiah?
Yep. And his disciples were not happy. When James and John found out that the Samaritans had rejected their master, they went to Jesus and said,
"Should you call down some fire from heaven?"
"Yeah, we can burn up those wicked Samaritans." But Jesus rebuked them, saying, "You don't even know what is in your hearts. I did not come to destroy life. I came to save life."
Man, I can't believe those Samaritans and how rude, deceitful, and foolish they were. Kind of reminds me of the neighbors.
It's okay. We'll hurry up and tell the story before they get here. So because the Samaritans rejected Jesus, he and his disciples had to go the long way around. But on the way, they stopped by a synagogue.
At this time, a Torah scholar came up to Jesus and said,
Excuse me, teacher. What shall I do to take possession of eternal life?
Well, what is written in the Torah? How do you interpret it?
You shall love your Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. And then you shall love your neighbor as yourself.
Good answer. Do this and you shall live.
Oh, I remember this. The Torah scholar was not satisfied. He wanted to make sure he was faithfully keeping the commandments. And so he asked Jesus,
when the Torah says, love your neighbor as yourself, what does it mean by neighbor? Who is my neighbor?
Jesus paused, smiled, and then told this story. Once upon a time.
Wait, in the middle of these questions, Jesus told a story?
Absolutely. Jesus was the greatest storyteller of all time. You see, Jesus wanted to make his teachings a little bit more clear. He wanted the people to have a real vision of what the kingdom of heaven looks like.
That's a story I want to hear.
This is the story that Jesus told. There was once a Jewish man who traveled from Jerusalem to Jericho, but on the way, he was attacked by bandits. They beat him up, they took his clothes, and they left him on the side of the road, half dead. Shortly after this, a priest came by, and he saw the man laying on the side of the road, but he crossed to the other side and went on his way. Shortly after this, a temple assistant also came by. He also saw the man, and he also crossed to the other side and went on his way, leaving the man there.
Wait, why aren't they helping this poor man? They sound like nice guys from the jobs that they have.
Well, you have to understand, they worked in the temple. They were temple assistants. They had to remain clean and pure, which means that if they were to touch a bloody dying man on the side of the road, they might become defiled.
Well, Jesus taught that love and mercy are more important than rituals. We talked about that in our last story.
Exactly, Nathan, and that was Jesus's point. The men of the story thought that the rituals were more important than mercy. They thought it was more important to remain clean and pure than to help someone in need.
So what happened? Did anybody actually help the poor man?
Someone did. Let's get back to the story.
As the Jewish man lay there, along the road came a Samaritan.
Oh no, a Samaritan? Of course he's not gonna help.
As he approached, the Samaritan saw the Jewish man and had compassion on him. The Samaritan soothed his wounds with olive oil and bandaged them. The Samaritan put the Jewish man on his own donkey and then took him to an inn where he cared for him. The next day, the Samaritan gave the innkeeper 2 silver coins and said,
take care of this man for me. And if his bill runs higher than this, I'll pay you back next time I'm here.
After finishing the story, Jesus turned to the Torah scholar and asked, now, of these 3, which one was the neighbor of the man who was attacked by bandits?
The Torah scholar was stunned by Jesus bringing a Samaritan into the story. He was showing that one's neighbor was not just a family member, a friend, or a fellow citizen, but it could also be one's enemy. The Torah scholar replied, the one who showed love and mercy, that was the neighbor.
With a nod, Jesus responded, go and do the same.
Rena, are you my neighbor?
Well, according to Jesus, all human beings are our neighbors.
Wait. I'm not a human being. I'm a puppet. Am I still your neighbor?
Of course, Remy. You ready to sing?
Sure thing, neighbor.
Everybody needs a little love.
It's true.
This is something from God above.
Of course.
Everybody needs some respect.
Amen.
It's not about who is correct.
Not at all.
Love your neighbor. Oh. need some compassion.
Of course.
Grace will never go out of fashion.
Never.
Everyone needs encouragement.
Yes.
The best kind of nourishment.
Yummy, yummy.
Love your neighbor all your days. Love your neighbor always.
Wow, that was a wonderful song about loving your neighbor.
That story Jesus told is so amazing. Out of the three, the Samaritan, the one that is supposed to be a Jewish man's enemy, was the one that showed love and mercy.
And see, that was Jesus's point. Everyone is our neighbor, even those we think are our enemies. We are to show love to everyone, even if they're being mean to us. So, what do you think, Nathan? Are you gonna be all right with the neighbors coming over?
Yeah, I guess so. Maybe if I'm nice and show them love, maybe they'll be nice back and let me borrow their lawnmower.
Nathan, showing love to your neighbor is not about getting things. It's about being selfless, not selfish.
You're right, Majors. Maybe I need to hear some more stories from Jesus. Should we tell another one?
Sure. Travel back with me to the time of Bible times. Oh, they're here. Well, we don't have time right now, but we will soon. Come on back when we go
into the Bible.
Hi, welcome to Behind the Scenes of Into the Bible. I'm here with David Mankow. He was the director for season one and season two of Into the Bible. The first question I have for you, David, is what is a director and what do you do?
One second. This is bothering me. Still rolling? Cool. Is that fixed now? Is that good? So part of my job as a director is to run the set, kind of like that. That happens a whole bunch on set. And you know, work with you and Majors, giving them directions to get to an emotional place and helping them tell the story.
So what's been one of your favorite shots of this season of Into the Bible?
I have really enjoyed using the 16 millimeter lens. For those of you who don't know cameras and cinematography that well, the 16 millimeter lens is a really wide lens and you can do a whole lot of fun things with it.
And what's been one of your favorite things about working on Into the Bible? You were on season one and now season two. So what's been your favorite part about working on the show?
Yeah, I think it's just really awesome to create great Christian content for kids. Knowing that I had a part in making really good quality content that is biblically based, talking about Christ, talking about his love, and talking about his character, you know, that's really important to me as a parent now.
Well, David, thank you so much for the interview, and thank you so much for all your work on this show. This show would not be happening without you, and you've been a great director. All right, that's it for Into the Bible, the behind the scenes.
All right, that's a cut. Cool.
On the way, they stopped by a synagogue.
Are you kidding me? They put trash all over their lawn?
Nathan, come over here and help me clean. And you know what? When we're done here, we'll go over there and help them clean.